Good afternoon. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
For three chambers, it sounds like we'd have a little stronger good afternoon. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Okay, that sounds much better. It is a pleasure today to get to welcome Governor McMaster to the three chambers of the Golden Strip. Don't be frightened, we don't have a stripper, but it's called Golden Strip. Not yet. Okay, but we are so excited to have you here, and I'm also very privileged to get to welcome you to my neighborhood. I live just down the street here, and we're very appreciative of this wonderful building that we have here. This is a good example of what public and private partnerships can do for communities and how the arts have restored our community here in Fountain Inn. But it's my pleasure to get to share a little bit about Governor McMaster. As we all know, he is the 117th governor of our great state of South Carolina. He served as our lieutenant governor. He's also served as our attorney general. He's no stranger to the upstate, for his wife, Miss Peggy, is a native of Spartanburg. So he has a Spartanburg sweetheart, so he is not a stranger to those of us that live here in the upstate. Also, I'd like to share a little something personal about the governor. At the time, he was the lieutenant governor, but it was my privilege to get to serve as a delegate to the National Republican Convention. With the 50 of us there, the delegates would take turns with the other delegates who were not permanent delegates, they're alternate delegates. And Lieutenant Governor McMaster was our chairman of our delegation that was sent to represent our state. And I'll tell you something that really impressed me about then Lieutenant Governor McMaster. He, of course, was there to nominate President Trump for the Republican ticket. And he had the opportunity to go, I'm sure, anywhere he wanted to go in that massive building that we were in and attend any function that he wanted to attend. He had the credentials around his neck that allowed him to travel in and out of any of the box seats or anything that he did. But when the time came, you know where he was? On the front seat of the South Carolina delegation area. He sat with us through all the meetings at night, and it was just wonderful to see that he is a governor of the people, not just for the people, but of the people, because he was right there with us the whole time. And as he's become our governor, he has done the same thing. He's a governor of the people. He and his family have spent their lifetime being public servants to our great state. Join me in welcoming Governor Henry McMaster.
Keep us ahead of these 50 other states that are all trying to do the same thing that we're trying to do, and that is to build a great prosperity in our states for the future. And this is echoing on me a little bit. If y'all can hear me, that sounds right. So what I'd like to do very briefly before we get to the questions, I'd like to answer anything, I'd like to hear any ideas that you have. Because that's where the good ideas come from, is people who are doing things in their communities, in their businesses, in their families. And some travel, some don't travel, but you see things and you learn things and you gather up wisdom, and every now and then There's a real good idea in there, and I'd like to hear about it. That's what I spend a lot of time doing, reading. I read somewhere where Warren Buffett, who's made a lot of money by wise investments, says he spends 80% of his time reading. That's pretty good. And I don't spend that much time, but I remember Jack Kemp. Y'all remember Jack Kemp? He was fabulous. According to Morton Kondracki and the other fellow's name I remember in a minute, they wrote a book and they said that he is the most outstanding American who never was president. Man, he was just bristling with ideas. I worked on his campaign with him way back. He was always reading a book, always carrying some book that I would never have picked up, Russian history and stuff like that. And he had a head full of ideas, and that's what made him, number one, such a happy man, such a good man on the football field. You remember, quarterback for the Buffalo Bills, and then was in Congress for a long time. But he had ideas. He was always searching for ideas. And he was always happy, never negative. Never saw him frown. If you think about it, you never saw Ronald Reagan frown, except when he got shot. And then when he was at Reykjavik, you remember, and he couldn't get Gorbachev to go along with the Gorbachev wanted him to give up the strategic defense initiative, Star Wars, in order to facilitate a nuclear ban treaty. And Reagan wouldn't do it. And when he put Gorbachev in the car, he was frowning then because he knew he'd miss that opportunity. But he was not about to let his country become weak. And because he did that, the next thing that happened, we saw him at the wall in Berlin. And you know the story on that one. That Reagan was a deep thinking man, always looking for ideas as well, and embraced the supply side economics, and that was caused great economic expansion in the country, and it's the same thing that we ought to do here. But on the way to that speech, it had been the speech, you know, the presidents have speech writers, but they go back through and they edit and they put in this and take out that. And he would get the speech back and he'd write in there to tear down this wall. He wanted to tell Mr. Gorbachev, and he'd send the speech back out, and he'd come back the next day, he'd be gone. They went back and forth, according to him. And on the way to the wall, he's riding in the vehicle, and he said something to the folks riding with him. He said, well, I guess I'm going to disappoint those boys from Harvard, but I'm putting it back in there. And he, of course, got on the wall, and you remember he did frown. He said, Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall. And you remember, it wasn't long after that, that wall did come down, and everything has changed then. And now we have fracking for fuel. That's changed the world just as much as almost as much as the steam engine, almost as much as the computer chip has changed the world. So we're in a new world, and that whole new world is coming to South Carolina. What I've seen is an enormous amount of interest, as particularly as lieutenant governor and governor, but over the years doing various things, you've seen it yourself. We have a lot of countries that are looking to do business in this country, and they're looking more and more to do business in South Carolina. So our job is to see that they are welcome, because as they come in, that also helps the businesses that are here. It creates more and more jobs. These new discoveries, inventions, and all that, the payroll that they have, leads to a cascade of ideas and opportunities that lift the whole place up. What I've learned in my time as a lawyer for, 43 years, and also in public office for about a dozen or so of those years, is that if the economic prosperity of a place is moving on, that is, if we're growing economically, if people have work, if people have jobs, a lot of the other problems we have go away. Maybe you've seen it too, but criminal domestic violence goes down, all domestic violence is criminal domestic violence. You see drug usage go down, you see marriages go up, you see divorces go down, you see all kinds, you see my happy children, education gets better, everything works better if you have an expanding, growing economy with good jobs for the people. So that ought to be the centerpiece on any sort of plan initiated by the government to make people stronger and have a better community, better futures for their own children. So that's the way I see it, and there are a lot of parts of it. You got a strong law enforcement part, you have a strong education part, you have a strong environmental part. We couldn't have a better natural environment than we have here in South Carolina, and all the explorers hundreds of years ago were saying so to their sovereigns when they came over and saw this place. They were writing back and saying so. So what do we have now that makes us so attractive to these businesses from other countries who see us in a different light, probably, than we see ourselves? Well, this is what I've learned. I've learned that they're intrigued by the idea of being able to collaborate with a research university. That would be Clemson, Carolina, USC, that is, and MUSC. And those sorts of collaborations are going on now. When the companies come in and I meet with them in the state house or the mansion, if they don't bring it up, I do, about the fact that we have these three research universities and they can collaborate with them. And they're very interested in that. And just as an example, on the corner of Blossom and Assembly Street in Columbia right now, capital city, IBM has a national data analytics headquarters. And they recently have brought in their computer system, I guess you'd call it, called Watson. What is Watson? Watson is a data analytics system. And they can predict when camshafts are going to run out, when nails, when wheel covers are going to run out, when tires are going to run out, when anything in moving parts in an engine. They put all this into the computer, and they can tell you when the truck out there, the brand new truck you have, when the camshaft, when the drive shaft, when something will happen to that. They can do all of that. That is an enormous advantage to have in economic development. And what the man in charge of it told me the other day was, I was joking, I said, well, I hope you'll be able to do that with human bodies before long. And he said, well, actually, we have done a project on cancer. He said, we've done a project on cancer, and it was an enormous project, and they had MDs and scientists who were working to predict the course of cancer in humans. And then they had Watson taking in the same data and predicting the course of cancer in those same humans. And Watson beat the professors and the doctors and the scientists by 30%. And this is the first time they've done such a project. That is astounding that they can do that. But they do that in cooperation and collaboration with these research universities. Clemson's doing the same thing. MUSC is doing the same thing. That's something that we have that other states don't have. Few of them do, but they don't have a port. And in fact, they're never going to have a port because they're not on the ocean. So there's nothing they can do. Our port is deep. It's getting deeper. We're successful in getting some money put into the budget. It took some last minute work. We have a very cooperative White House these days. And we were able to get some money in the budget to allow the old Corps of Engineers to give the okay to go ahead. That was just a few months ago. And we will start dredging this month. And that means the depth of that harbor will be enough to where those big ships that can carry 13,000 those containers that you see going up on the highway on the trucks will be able to get into the Charleston port day and night. And we have one rail line going through Greer, as you know, crossing 85, and we opened up another one, starting work on it, going through Dillon, going across 95. No other state has that. A deep water port in Dubuque, two inland ports connected to it. What else? The best technical college system in the United States, started in 1961. That's not something you just start out one day and build. You got to take some planning, takes a lot of work. But we've built houses up where it's recognized now as the best in the country. What does that mean? That means something unique to South Carolina. That means that we can send people from our technical colleges to China or Japan or England or anywhere we want to, and we do it, to look at their plant, to look at their people, look at their traditions and their customs and those machines and see how they work, and come back here and design a curriculum to train people to work on those machines if they bring their company over here. And that's what they've been doing. And it's just, it's amazing to see the interest in South Carolina. I said it and I say it again, no other state does that. Right now in South Carolina, our big challenge is having enough people to fill the jobs. We haven't been in this situation before. Usually, we don't have enough jobs for the people, but now we don't have enough people for the jobs. We're short about 60,000, and they are good paying jobs. They're in these plants, and these plants, ladies and gentlemen, the workers in these plants, this takes a, you got to step back and take a look at these new plants. They have $1 million pieces of equipment in there. The workers that go there, that work these big machines, they don't carry toolboxes anymore, they carry laptops. There's computers, it's high tech, it's high skill. You can't just learn it by on the job. You got to be trained. You got to go to one of these technical colleges and learn those skills. We have apprenticeship programs. Wilbur Ross, the U.S. Secretary of Commerce, says that our apprenticeship and our workforce development programs in South Carolina are a model for the nation. Someone said that twice when we were announcing that Samsung was coming to Newberry County. Now, that's a big deal, and it's a big deal in any county. But it's true, and these companies know that. This is something that we started, maybe some of you worked on developing those plans or working in the technical assistance. That's something that nobody else has. But we have that, we have the port, we have the cascading innovations and ideas from these research universities working with these companies. It's just a set of assets that cannot be beat. Also, we're the lowest in union participation in the whole country, 1.something%. Why is that? Because we treat people right, we pay them well, we expect them to do the right thing, they do, and that's why we're the lowest in union participation. And we have great weather. You can be at the beach in the morning, be on the coast. Most states don't have a coast. We take it for granted. People go to the beach all a lot of our friends from Kansas, Nebraska, all those places never been to the beach. When I remember this, in college, there were people there that had never been to the beach in their whole lives. I've been going since I can remember. We take those things for granted. But you put all those together, it's the beaches and the mountains and the rivers and the flora and the fauna and these great institutions that have been built over the years on top of all that, and it is an unbeatable combination that nobody else has. Now, there's some other states that have some great things, and they're trying to steal ideas from us, from the model we've created. We're trying to steal ideas from them, from whatever it is that they're doing right. But the main thing, this is the most interesting part, and all these companies that I've talked to, and there's an awful lot of them, they've all said the same thing in different ways. But they've said all those assets, those things that I mentioned, said those are great. But the main reason we came here was because of the people. What do you mean? South Carolina, the chairman of BMW said, South Carolina is a handshake state. If somebody from South Carolina gives you their word, they'll keep it. And the man, one of the bosses of Walmart, was at GT Tire in Chester just last week, I was up there. He said, South Carolina is a handshake state. He said, all of this work that you see out here in this plant and Walmart coming in here, all that was done on handshakes. With the local development people, the state people, all on handshakes. He said, this is a unique place. So there we are. That's what we've got. And we've got great, great opportunity. We can outrun any state with the way that we do business. We can outrun and outcompete any state in the country. And so that's what we have to do. And one last advantage that I've noticed over the years, and maybe you have too, is most of us are related to each other, some kind of way or another. Because I heard Liz Grant, I remember Liz said some time ago, he said when he was a young lawyer, he had all the people would come in his office asking a lot of unusual questions. One he heard from time to time was this, they said, Mr. Lawyer, if we get married in South Carolina and divorced in Georgia, are we still cousins? See that ability to make a phone call, to make a deal, to shake a hand, and turn something on a dime, turn around a question quick and move, that's a great advantage. We're mobile and we can get things done. So what we have to do is what Christy Todd Whitman said to me years ago. She'd been the governor of New Jersey, and under President Bush, I think the first President Bush, she was the head of the EPA, and we were at a meeting and she was speaking in Columbia at the building that overlooks the Capitol and overlooks the university. Oh, it's just beautiful, and the rivers down there, and the beautiful sky, and green trees are going up to the horizon. And we were talking about these various advantages and the business climate in South Carolina. And she says, well, yes, you do have it all, but I hope you don't mess it up. Because they messed up some things in New Jersey. They messed up things in a lot of states. So far, we have not messed anything up. And if we don't mess it up by raising taxes too high, I want to lower taxes. I believe in supply side economics. I believe that if you lower taxes on people, they'll have more money, they'll spend more money. That means there'll be more people working, there'll be more businesses growing. That means there'll be more people paying taxes, but at a lower rate. And that way you get more money into the government to do the things that are necessary. And you should not be doing things that are not necessary. And that keeps government small, and the people have their own money. The more money people can keep from their labors, the better we are. And that's been demonstrated in history. President Kennedy did it, President Reagan did it, and we need to do that here as well. North Carolina just lowered a lot of their taxes, one way or another. There's some other states doing things like that. We need to see what we can do. So that's my story. How can we mess this up? By having too many regulations, by depending on government to do everything when there are volunteers and charities and people that can do the same thing and doesn't cost anybody anything, and also by having too many regulations, too many taxes. So what I'd like to hear is any ideas that you have, or that you may have later, at any time that you think would make things work better for the people of South Carolina, because I try to accumulate those. I seek your advice, I seek your wisdom and your insight. And remember that the only stupid question, as they used to tell us in the Army, is the only stupid question is the one you don't ask. Well, I say the same thing about the only stupid idea is the one you don't share. So I'd love to hear from you. And that's the end of my talk. And thank you.
My name is Jason Hawks. I'm in Simpsonville. Actually, it's picking up quick. I had two questions. I'm the parent of a twin 7-year-olds, and in this area we are fortunate that we have very good public schools. And as our children continue to get older and go to higher grades, I just wanted to know what your thoughts were on the continued improvement of the charter schools. We've started to see a lot of those in this area, and I think those have brought a lot of quality programs, and I'm just interested in your thoughts on that. And secondly, if you don't mind, we've grown tremendously here in the upstate since I've been here over the last nearly 20 years now. But the increase in numbers of people, the increased business flow, the increased transportation flow in the cities, on the state roads, on all the roads, obviously is an issue, and I know that's something that's through the gas tax and other things. When will we begin to see the effects of that on our roads here in the upstate? Should we start to see more inflow, more projects taking place? Is it 6 months, a year, 3 years out?
On the roads, I think it's probably longer than that, because there's a long pipeline to, you gotta get contracts, you got people working in other states, and so there's a delay. You can't just, say we can work on this road and start work. It's a lot easier to start repairing roads. But on that, I'm glad you brought that up, because I want to tell you, when the gas tax was proposed, I don't like the idea of raising taxes. You know, every tax that we ever say, oh, just a little bit, not going to hurt anybody. But actually, we keep raising those things for you. You know it, you just, a lot of your money is gone. You look at the federal taxes, how high those are. I don't know how we've gotten to the place where we're so heavily taxed. We got to change it. But on that particular thing, I was doing the research, because the gas tax bill, a lot of proposals being made, and it ended up with 12 cents over however many years it would be phased in, 2 cents a year. Well, that doesn't sound like much. And they were saying, well, but for the average vehicle that it gets 25,000 miles and is driven about 15,000 miles, that only comes to $200 or $300 a year. Well, folks, if you look around, and I read a thing in the paper just the other day where someone had written into whatever the Dear Abby thing or something like that is these days, and it was a mother writing in for advice on how to handle her son, who was he's an adult, but he had expected about $700 in his refund and only got three or something like that. That was about $300 or $400 he would expect he expected that he didn't get. And the point of the thing was that that was a big deal to him and his mother. That was a big deal. That $300 or $400 was a lot of money. Well, there are a lot of people who $300 or $400 a year is a lot of money. They don't have enough money. And when the people that are in that shape, when people, if they have a flat tire, one more flat tire, they can lose their job. When they have people who can't go to the doctor because they don't have anybody to take care of somebody at the house. When those folks, and there are a lot of us like that in our state, when they are having a hard time, that's not the time to go around raising taxes. So I did my research and talked to some plumbers and electricians and those kind of people. My wife has some apartments around the university, and we've had people in the last few years say, "Ms. McMaster, I'm not going to be able to come to work on your plumbing over there anymore." Why is that? It costs too much to drive in from Gaston or Peden or wherever it is. Just costs. It costs too much to come to Columbia from the other side of the river. Can you do it? And that 25 miles to the gallon and 15,000 miles, I've talked to people with companies with trucks, and they might get 7 miles to the gallon. They might go to 30,000. So anyway, I started looking around to see what the facts are, which is always a good idea before you pass a law. See what the facts are and hear both sides of it. And we were at church in Peden, talked to a man at church who had been with the highway department. And he said, "Well, you know, that $623 million that goes into the highway department from the current gas tax, $325 million or so of that goes to pay the employees at the highway department. It doesn't go to the roads." I don't know the precise numbers. I couldn't believe it. And so I did a little inquiry, and it was actually more than that. That road tax, the gas tax, much of it goes to other things. Some of it comes back when we work on a federal highway, we get some of that money back. But it ended up somewhere around 35, 40, maybe 42, 43% of the current gas tax does not, it never seen a road, never will see a road. So that leaves, say that leaves 50% or 60% or maybe 65% of the money to go to the roads. Well, which roads do we go to? There's another problem. The highway department comes up with priorities. But when you have the highway commissioners and other things, and other forces, often political forces, that get in, and money doesn't go to the roads that it ought to go to. So that gives us a real problem. So that's why I vetoed that. Because if we spend the money that came from the gas tax on the roads, we'd have plenty of money. But it was over my veto. So my plan now is to be sure that we follow the priorities set by the highway department. We see to it that we're putting the money on the right road, see to it we're not wasting any money, see to it that there's no fraud or anything like that where money is being siphoned off. And if we do that, we can have plenty of infrastructure. We can fix the bridges, we can fix the road. I want to fix the ones we have before we start building new ones. And that essentially is the plan of the highway department. So that, I hope that answers that question. A quick, short answer to the first question. Charter schools are great. As you know, they're public schools, so they, once they're approved either by the school district or by the state school district to be allowed to set up and run, they get the money from the state per pupil that goes to the other public schools as well. But they don't get the money to build the building and maintain the building, so they have to come up with some other funds. Just this morning, I was at the Meyer Center. Y'all heard of that? It's in Greenwood. Fantastic. They have 100 children with disabilities. We went all around the building. They had 67 staff and teachers for 100 children. 67 staffers for 100 children. There was more one-on-one going on in there than you see in a basketball game. It was close, positive attention. And there's no way that those children would ever get into. They keep them there. They only have 100, and this is the only such school in the state. What I want to do, Chris Neely is the boss, Dr. Lester Myers was the one that started it way back in 1954. The became a charter school in 1999, then went to the state district going a few years ago. But I'm encouraging them to see if there are other locations where they can do the same thing. Because if those children don't, if they're not helped, if those, and they haven't been there from 6 months old to 8 years old, it almost makes you cry with happiness to see what they're doing. But that could not be done anywhere else. When a disabled child goes to a public school, they can't do all of those things. I mean, that's what they do all day long, is working with those child or children, everything that they need to do. And when they do get to the public school, they can manage, they can go on through. We have to do more of that, but there's a lot of other kinds of public school, charter schools as well. I'm for all of them. And I want to do everything I can to see that we allow them to grow and flourish, because that essentially is free enterprise out there responding to the needs of the people. I'm involved. But we have to do a lot of things in the public schools. We have to allow the private schools, allow the charter schools, allow the magnet schools. The old days of education is the same for everybody that are gone. You know that. And if we can't educate these children and get them up, then these visions and dreams that I've been telling you about are not going to happen. Does that answer that one? I'll try to be a little short.
Anyone else have a question?
Yes.
Hi, thank you, Governor. My name is Andrea Merritt. I work at Sports Club. I'm also a member of the Simpsonville Chamber. I was curious on your thoughts on the FIT, Personal Health Investment Today Act, which would provide tax savings for citizens who choose to live a healthy lifestyle for things like health club dues, fitness equipment, and things like children's sports registrations.
Is that a state law or federal law?
I believe it's a federal law, but they're looking for state support.
I'm not familiar with that law, but I'm familiar with doing all those things. I think we ought to encourage them. Here's a fact I heard from Nick, y'all remember Nick Zace, who's the superintendent of education. He's been nominated by the president to be the deputy secretary of education in Washington. And he's got a head full of ideas. But this is what he told me just a few days ago. He said the students today, when they leave, they've studied this recently, when they leave for summer, it used to be, when they came back to start school in the fall, they lost weight, even though they were growing. Their weight was down. And then they gained weight during the school year, because they've been out active all summer, and they lost weight. But now, he says, they come in after the summertime, and they've all gained weight. And he says, that's because we're not going out and playing baseball and basketball and running around and doing all the things that children used to do, because they're staying inside and they're on the screens and the machines and all that. That's not a good thing for the future. I think it was George Patton said you got to get up and walk around every 20 minutes because your brain freezes up. All the evidence is that physical activity and eating right and all that is essential for good health. And some of y'all might have told you, my daddy started exercising at YMCA during college, and his last time he went to YMCA, he had a regimen on the horizontal bar, swing around on that bar, and doing three sets of 20 pull-ups and all that. I don't know anybody can do that except some folks in the service, I think. But he was 87 then, and he ended up tied his last case at 93, and closed the office door at 99 and passed away just under 101. And he ate right, he exercised right, and that's what I'm trying to do. I'm gonna try to keep up with it. But we got a lot of people who just don't know that you need to do that. So anything that encourages that kind of activity, I think is good. I'm not sure what the best way to do it is. So I think a good example, I think leadership, programs, if people see other people doing things and enjoying it, the young people, it's always the young people we have to play to or have to work for. I think we can encourage that kind of activity. And the more healthy people we have, the less people we have going to the hospital with all kind of problems. Once you get to be 50 or 60 years old, it's never too late. But we got to stay out of the hospital, and one way to do that is to have exercise, movement, eat right, and those sorts of things. So I'm for all that. As far as tax breaks, I don't know, I'd have to see that, but I'm certainly for good health. And on another point on that, we need to be on our health care. The question should not be how we will treat these people once they get in this condition. A larger question, I think, is what are we going to do to keep them from getting in that position and condition in the first place? And I don't think we're concentrating on doing that. More questions?
I think we have another question.
This lady right there.
Thank you. I'm Janice Curtis. I'm mayor of Simpsonville. You had said that you're for less regulations. Could you give us some examples of where we are over-regulated in our state and what you're looking at as far as cutting those regulations?
Yes.
Thank you.
One of them is in daycare. So I'm trying to remember some of them that have been brought up recently. I've been a little bit surprised we have not had a lot of them brought up, but some of them are daycare centers, a lot of people feel that the requirements are too stringent for that. Some of them, you would call them regulations, are teachers' requirements, that you have a degree in education, which does not guarantee that you can be a teacher. Right now, if you are a retired PhD from a company in say, chemistry or something that you've been working all your life, retired, you can't go teaching in public school. There may be some temporary programs for it, but because you don't have that education degree, that four-year degree, you're not qualified, or considered not qualified to teach in public school, although you can teach in colleges and universities. I'd like to change that to open it up to where that kind of talent and wisdom important is available teaching. Also, permits, construction businesses, and all connected with the construction businesses, which are the kind of things that are really going to explode with the kind of investment that we have in businesses that are expanding and coming to South Carolina, because we make things. It's not service stuff. We make things. When you make buildings, or you're building roads, or you're doing all and making houses, you have to have people that work with their hands and their brains. So when these companies want to go to work, they find themselves having to go to sometimes 15 or 20 different jurisdictions, city and county, to get a permit to do this, and then go get a wait line, get a permit to do that, and then go. And it takes a long time. Those are three that I'm thinking of right off. We have to do something like that to make it easier for people to work. Okie doke. Anything else? Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir. All right, Mark.
I think I can speak loud enough. As you well know, if Gary is here, next legislative year, I think we're going to have to look at the state pension plan a little bit further. I know that you have made some comments about the state pension plan. Would you share those with us today? Your thoughts about what the legislation has already been passed and some of your thoughts of potential legislation that could help that plan stay fruitful.
Thank you. As you well know, and as Gary Smith well knows, and others well know, we owe more than we're going to have. So for the state employees. So what we did in the last session was to provide some more state money and require more money from the employees for those that are already in the system and those coming into the system to balance that out. But it's an unfunded liability. We can't do it. That's why, you remember the story about Flint, Michigan? Remember when nobody could drink the water and because the pipe system was all rotted out and all that sort of stuff? Well, I did a little bit of inquiry and find out how to get in that mess. That was the city of Flint, Michigan. And they said that the political bodies were so excessive and generous with the pensions for the city employees that they put all the money in the pensions and didn't have enough money to fix the pipes. Well, and you see what happened to them. And by the way, up in that part of the country, notably in Cleveland, I noticed these buildings in Cleveland on Main Street, beautiful buildings, stone carved buildings of all kinds, but most of them, or many of them, had vacancies down on the first floor. I inquired, and the population of Cleveland back in the 60s and maybe early 70s was something over 800, between 800,000 and 900,000 people, and today it's something like 385 or 425 or something like that. It's just drastically dropped. And that's because they're not running things smart. They're spending money on pensions and things that they shouldn't be spending it on, and wasting tax money. Of course, in this state, sunshine and the great economic prosperity that we can offer to people, people are coming here, they're leaving places like that. But the other part of that is to go into something like a 401k plan where the employee can put money into a fund that is some contribution is made by the government as well, and let the employee controls. We've got to shift away from the system that we have now, where it is a defined benefit system. That is, if you retire, you're going to get this much, depending on how long you work and what you. So I tell you what it is, you take the number of state years of employment, multiply it by your highest 3 years, the average of salary for your highest 3 years in there consecutive, and multiply that by 0.0182, and that gives you what your retirement. That's how it works. No matter how much money is in the system, and that's the problem. So we got to get out of it. But there may be some other ways. There are other states. I wish I could just call every one of them, get hold of somebody, and tell them exactly. And I do call these governors sometimes, but they don't know. They don't have any more ideas. They're looking just like I am. But we're looking for ideas on what to do to make it work better. Yes, Gary.
Thank you again, Governor, for coming to the Governor's Rift. Happy to be with you here at Town Hall. Appreciate you being here. One of the things we hear a lot from the federal area is about tax reform. That's something that not only affects the federal government, it's something we also have to deal with from the state level. Dr. Rebecca Gunn-Lotson did a report to the House Task Force on tax reform recently, in conjunction with Arthur Laffer, who you mentioned earlier, who worked for Reagan, who came up with the concept of the Laffer curve in the supply side of economics.
Precise.
One of the things that you pointed out was that in South Carolina we have the seventh highest commercial rate for property tax in the country. We have in the city of Columbia the highest industrial tax rate in the city of Columbia, highest industrial tax rate. With that in mind, one of the things that they also proposed, also they kind of broke out at that time, was they had put together a system where they can be looking at and analyzing taxes. What are the things that would make us more competitive and so forth. With what North Carolina and Georgia has done with their tax reform, we're in a position now that we have got to take and do something.
You are correct.
Would you mind speaking about that and what you plan on doing as far as that's concerned?
Yes, I'd be happy to. And I've done the same thing that you've done. Is I met with Dr. Gunn-Lotson last week, and we started going through her ideas and analyses and didn't get through, but we will get back together. And I think that's a great asset that we have. Everybody I've talked to for the last, I guess, 2 or 3 years has said that she is the one that has analyzed it better than anybody else. So I don't know what all the answers are to that, but I do know this with the sales tax, for example, that the sales tax raises whatever, I think it's $3 billion a year, but we also, through the exemptions, we lose $3 billion a year. It would come in, but there are a lot of exemptions. All right, I'll give you an idea of one is on food. Well, the idea is to have an exemption on food. You don't pay sales tax when you go to the grocery store. You don't pay sales tax. But the idea originated to be sure that those who did not have very much expendable money would be able to buy food, didn't want to put a burden on. But now with the various poverty programs, it seems So you wonder, and then you have some that are not flush with money for anything that'll have to pay some. Then you have people that probably wouldn't hurt very much to have to pay sales tax on food. But again, according to Arthur Laffer, you don't want to put such taxes, the less the better. And one interesting thing, so I don't know the answer to get the answer to your question. I don't know what the answer is, but I know that there's one out there. I know we can do a whole lot better than we're doing now. And I know for those of us who live in the city of Columbia, particularly people or businesses, if you don't own the building, well, if you get for homeowners, for your first home, some people have more than one, but that tax is fairly low. But when you have rental property or other property, it's not just the difference between the 4% tax and the 6% tax. Usually it ends up as it does in the city of Columbia, something like about three times as much as you pay on an owner-occupied home. So we got to do something. I don't know the answer, but I can promise you I'm looking hard, and we're going to find something. I know we'll have plenty of time to talk about that. But in Arthur Laffer's recent book, just quickly, he went back and looked at it's a great statistical analysis, if you like statistics. But he thought the best way to compare the impact of taxes and growth was to take those states that did not have an income tax in 1960 and don't still, and those states who imposed an income tax in 1960 or so and still have one. And the trends are remarkable. In the cases where there's no income tax, the gross domestic product of the state is just going up steadily. In the others, it's going down, down, down. One of them is Ohio, it's going down. And it's real clear, the evidence is in on what works. So we have to figure out a way to get there.
And the state that he moved to Tennessee?
Sir?
And the state that he moved to Tennessee?
That's right. No, I could have some certification. I tried to all day, but I don't want to stay here too long.
I thought I had really struck it when you said Gary, and that's my name as well. I stood up at the same time, but Smith asked better questions than me anyway. I want to thank you for coming and giving us an opportunity to hear some of your ideas. Some I like, some I'm out still judging. But I do want to ask you to oversee, I know you can't do all transportation, but the one thing that I've noticed is from people looking, whoever's in that governor's seat, whoever's controlling in the power seats, Florence and other places, they got the money. Now, it hasn't always been down there, because we've had money in the upstate at times, and big highways go out there that are built, they get plenty of money. But what I'm looking at is fairness for all sections of the state. We've got a great state, and the upstate is not by itself in having good places for people to live, but there's some pockets in this state that instead of going and dumping into their education system, I think you need to get the economic people to go down there and help them find some business people to go down, because that's one of your things that you said, that they're prospering and they got good businesses, it'll take care of some of the rest of the things down there. And I think your schools will grow better as well. Mm-hmm. So that's one thing I think needs to be looked at. The pension plan, I don't have any answers for you. I'm prospering from it right now. I'm a school teacher from old. And so I'm retired. I've been retired for 12, 13 years now. And that's one of the most complicated issues that you've got to work with. Y'all been working a long time, still don't have an answer. Then there's one little bug that I just always bothered. When I retired, I'm getting ready to retire, they still wanted me to go back. If I wanted to teach, I still had to go back and take courses. They need to do away with that. They weren't going to pay me any more money, because once you get to the end of where they give you a raise, every 20, up to 20 years, I think it is now, I'm not sure, but they're not giving you any more money, but still they want you to go pay for those courses, which is not cheap. And then you go and to renew your certificate. If they did that, they would have more people out there. Of course, I think there's some other reasons they do that as well, but Just take a look at it. I'll follow up on that if you even care to want to know those ideas you talked about.
Yeah, I'd love to.
But thank you for coming, giving us an opportunity to share it with you and hear your and hear what you have. So, thank you.
I appreciate that. As far as economic development goes, I know the Department of Commerce, and I know Roger, we always have a big map out there. We talk to them about all the places and the greatness of these places where often there's no big industry. One good thing is out there, and you'd be the one drawing all the workers in. Get a training, you don't have to compete with somebody else for labor. But ultimately, they make the decision. And they make it based on what they think is best for them. We can't make them go anywhere. But we sure do sell the state. And I'll tell you again, it is easy to do. All you have to do is just list all those things that I talked about and then let them go look at that. And next thing you know, they're coming back, want more, want to keep on talking. This is. If I could get one thing through the minds of the people of this state, it was expressed by James Barker at Clemson and Harris Pastees at USC, who said, I don't want to hear anybody say South Carolina's a small, poor state and we can't do anything. I don't want to hear it. It's not true. And that's been locking us down for a lot of years. You know the story of the city slicker that went to the circus and he saw the big jumbo elephant, had a little tiny chain around his foot and his leg, a little teeny little stake over there, and there he was, standing there. And the city slicker said to the ringmaster, that's not the hole, that thing ain't gonna hold that elephant. He just didn't walk away. He said, we put it on the Williams baby, he tried to get out and he couldn't get out, so now he doesn't try. Often I find us thinking that we can't do it. But I guarantee you, these people from around the world that are coming in here, they say that these people in South Carolina can do it, and they, if they say they're going to do it, they will do it. Yes, sir.
Phil Plummer from the Fountain Inns City Council. Thank you for coming. Just a quick question. You referenced this in your comments earlier. 60,000 available jobs and difficult labor market. We are almost in crisis mode in this county with being able to find good people to work. So what are the thoughts about these continued industry coming in? How are we going to attract more people to fill these good paying jobs that we have?
That right there is the million-dollar question. And what I've thought of so far is we have to use these assets that we have to attract people to go into that kind of. And I'm talking about plumbers, carpenters, electricians, truck. You've got long-distance truck drivers can make $100,000 a year right now. A welder on the pipeline, a million hours is going to do a pipeline. They can start, if they get a certificate, a two-year degree from a technical college for welding, they can start off at about $75,000 and it'll be $100,000 in no time. People don't realize that. The biggest obstacle we have have the training capacity at the technical college. We need to ramp some of them up. A lot of improvements we can make. But the biggest problem that I've been able to put my finger on is the same one that these executives from BMW and Volvo and these other places are saying they see, and that is there's a cultural problem. There's an attitudinal problem to where you have a young man or another young woman who graduates from high school, but they really don't want to go to college. They don't want to study whatever it is they study at college. They might not have the money. They might want to do something else for a while. As people say, if you take a year or two off, you usually do better if you do it when you did go to a four-year school. But for generations now, we have been believing, and at one time it may have been true, but we've been believing that if you didn't have a four-year college degree, you were not a success. And that's nonsense. I think they kicked Bill Gates out of school. He's doing pretty well. Phil Graham, former U.S. Senator, he flunked the third, fifth, and eighth grade and ended up being a PhD finally. We have to get over that because the jobs today are not like, say, working in the mills used to be. That was hard work. It was repetitious. You had to do it right. But you're using mainly your hands, but not so much. a day and not like that. You ought to go into these plants and see these guys. They're working with robots, and it's highly skilled, and they're not sweating. It's not that kind of work. It is high skilled, highly paid, clean, respectable work. And I'm looking, been thinking of a TVA, maybe we could put out there one day, where you have a young man saying to his mom and dad, said, I want to go to technical college and learn how to do something, and go work in that plant, because they have robots, and it's great, and I love that kind of stuff. I want to build things, I want to use my brains and my hands. Mom and dad, I don't know, son, we didn't go to college, and we always wanted you to go to college, and that means a four-year college, and technical college as well, it's higher education. But we always wanted you to study French literature or something. But that's what we've always wanted. We hope you do. And say, well, Mom, Dad, I've been up there to the technical college, and in 2 years I can have an associate's degree in something. I won't have any college debt. I'm right out of high school. I want to marry me early, and we can buy a house. We got 22 years of buying houses in South Carolina right now. Did finish technical college, get a good job, get married, and buy a house. Really something. But I want to, that's what I want to do. And then later, once I get set and established and doing what I want to do, maybe I will finish up with another 2 years. I can do it online in some places, universities. Maybe I will, maybe I won't. That's what I want to do. Dad, well, I'm sorry. Son, I wish you'd go on and get that degree. He said, well, Dad, if I get this thing, I'll be starting off at $85,000. Starting off, how much are you making? Well, son. We have to break through that cultural picture we've been looking at for all these years. And it's getting ready to change some more. It's astonishing the stuff that's coming along. And again, these research universities and these companies that are hooking up with them, it's a win-win for both, because they will produce ideas and inventions and things that will cascade down into all the factories, all the plants, all the way down to the corner store. And we have the opportunity to have good work, happy, fun, clean, healthy lives for people in South Carolina, I think right now more than ever before. But we can't tax people too much. We've got to quit regulating things that don't need to be regulated. You know, you've heard all the stories about the laws on the state books that you can't back the horse up on the street and stuff like that. We really don't need those laws anymore. We got a lot of improvement. We need to sharpen and smarten up our laws and regulations so we can really set this spirit and this potential we have free. And it can really soar to be able to pull it back. But it's true. There's nothing holding us back right now except some outdated attitudes and regulations and perhaps some laws. Nobody has it. More? Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir.
Cool. Thank you for having us be here. I'm Jim Gates from Lawrence, South Carolina. And
yeah, I'm some railroad.
That's right, yes, sir.
I knew it.
I'll see you by tonight. My question is about comments on the Dodd-Frank Act. What can we do to possibly get that eliminated? And then by doing this will certainly encourage small businesses to flourish here in all across our state and everything, and all across our nation. So in doing that and everything, what's your comments on that?
On the Dodd-Frank Act?
Yes, sir. The Durbin Amendment.
The what?
The Durbin Amendment, which is Dodd-Frank.
I know what Dodd-Frank is.
Yes, sir. What can you do?
I can encourage the people in Congress and the President to get rid of it. And I think President Trump, one of his first things was an executive order to go through and get rid of all the regulations. As you know, they're working on tax reform up there now. I hope that will happen. I don't know of anybody who thought Dodd-Frank was a good idea, all the restrictions. You know, all those restrictions on free enterprise just end up having unintended, some of the intended consequences are ruinous and counterproductive, but there are a lot of unintended consequences as well. we'd be better off without that. Any more? Well, y'all are pleasure to be here, so I wish you, and I look forward to seeing you.
Thank you.